Pathophysiology of Delirium in the Critical Care Unit by Dr. Chani Traube.
People often ask what causes delirium, and the answer is that its pathophysiology is incredibly complex and multifactorial. Simplistically, I like to think of delirium as being the result of three synergistic processes. One is the underlying disease that brought the child to the unit to begin with. The other is side effects of treatment for that disease. And the third is the highly abnormal environment in which these children are placed while they're critically ill. As an example, we can take almost any child in any of our units today. I can take the baby with RSV bronchiolitis and acute respiratory failure. So the underlying disease process, the respiratory failure with a concomitant hypoxia, puts this child at risk for delirium, as does the RSV infection itself. We then put this child on positive pressure ventilation, on invasive mechanical ventilation. The mechanical ventilator, the positive pressure, further increases delirium risk, as does the sedating medication that we prescribe to help the child tolerate the ventilator. We then take this baby, who's used to sleeping at home on their belly in their crib, and lie them flat on their back, usually mostly naked, in a cold ICU where they're exposed to lights and noise 24 hours a day. It's no wonder that this child is a setup for experiencing delirium during their critical illness. Regardless of whatever triggered the delirium, the final common pathway involves alteration in neurotransmission, specifically acetylcholine, but all the neurotransmitters have been implicated. And this alteration in neurotransmission leads to the cognitive and behavioral changes that we recognize as delirium.